I don't know about Guru. But Rachel introduced herself, and I don't know if any of you guys know Rachel, but apparently Rachel has been stood up a lot because I was very excited about coming. This has been on my calendar for a little while, but Rachel has emailed me like 5 times, you know, over the last week or so to make sure, you know, that I was coming. I was really expecting another email or a phone call this morning, but anytime I get an opportunity to talk about Chick-fil-A, I'm excited. Anytime I get an opportunity to talk about serving others, which is exactly what you guys do, I'm excited. I think it's probably a good idea for me to tell you a little bit about my history. Since I'm the customer service guru, I think it'll be interesting to find out that I haven't always been such a customer service guru. I will celebrate 26 years with Chick-fil-A in May. And so, yeah. So that means I was only 5 when I started. But I did start with Chick-fil-A when I was 15. It was my first public job. Now, most of you guys look pretty young. You're about my age, maybe a little bit younger. But my background is that both sets of my grandparents were farmers. And if you grew up in this area and you had family that were farmers, then that means you became a farmer too, right? How many people have ever helped out on the farm? Yeah, see, now when I say that to younger people, they're like, help on the farm. What do you mean help on the farm? But because both sets of my grandparents were farmers, that is what, I mean, from the time I was 10, when it got to be time to pick up watermelons, you went on out and you picked up watermelons. I mean, you did whatever. It was tobacco and watermelons and potatoes, and it was from the beginning until the end, you know, from the very end when the tobacco came out of the barn and it was time to tie it up and take it to market. And we did it all. And a matter of fact, I just started eating watermelon this year. Because if a watermelon busted, if you dropped it and busted, that was lunch. Oh, we're having watermelon for lunch today. And so it was like you were the most hated child if you were the one that dropped the watermelon. So I just have started eating watermelons. But by the time I was 15, I knew that if I did not get a public job, it was going to be another summer of putting in tobacco every day. And so I quickly hurried to try to get a public job. And I got a job at Chick-fil-A. Now, some of you may know someone that has worked here at our Chick-fil-A in Wilson at some point in time, but and they might have told you some horror stories about it. But I can tell you the experience that my folks have now, that onboarding experience, is so different than what I had. My first day included showing up and getting a little button-down white shirt. That was pre-used. It was a pre-owned shirt, which that's good. They were making good use of resources. That was good. And I had a pair of brown polyester pants that were kind of like this, but they were the kind that have a permanent seam in it, so you didn't have to worry about ironing them, which was good. And then I had a little bow tie thing that went on the shirt. And, you know, 15-year-olds love to dress like that, right? And then we had a little beanie hat that went with it too, that looked kind of like I was gonna do some painting or something. And so that was my first day. I also signed my paperwork and I got a sheet that had all the products and all the prices on it. And my boss said, I want you to be here on Saturday morning at 10 o'clock, wear black shoes, doesn't matter what kind, just wear black shoes, and memorize all these products and prices before then. Now, immediately, you're probably thinking about the Chick-fil-A you know now, with the cookies and the great salads and nugget trays. But, I mean, we didn't have nothing but probably 15 different items. You know, it was a sandwich, fries, coleslaw, that sort of thing. So it really wasn't a reasonable expectation to memorize all the products and all the prices. Well, you guys work around young people. What do you think a young person is going to do with a list to memorize, you know, between now and Saturday? Oh yeah, put it to the side. What are you talking about? It was in the floorboard of the back seat of my mom and daddy's car. I jumped in the car and threw that thing back there, and that was the last time I saw it until Saturday morning, about 2:50, when I was scrambling to get out of the car with my little beanie. And so I grabbed my paper as I'm running down the mall. Again, a mall back in the 80s was very different than Wilson Mall now. I mean, it was the place to be. There was no eBay and Amazon and outlet stores. So on Saturday morning, the mall was hopping. You know, there was people in there. There was things going on. They were eating chicken. And so I got there, and my boss was gracious enough that he was going to be the one to train me that day. And so our method was, well first of all, our counters, I'm 5'2". The counter came up to about right here. Things were very different then than they are now. You know, now you go in and the counter's way down here. But no, it was way up here, and we had this register sitting up there that was like this big and weighed like 50 pounds. And really, it was kind of a glorified adding machine. I mean, like, there was no buttons that said Chick-fil-A sandwich or sweet iced tea. It was like numbers and total, and that was it. And so that's why I needed to memorize my prices. I found that out pretty quickly. So my boss's regiment of training was is that he stood beside me, and as the customers come in, I took care of them. There was no screen that told you what you had rang up. You had to memorize the order while they're telling you, punch in the price, and then turn around and yell it to the people behind you that that's what they needed to make. And then you had to make all the drinks. Oh man, for a 15-year-old, I was really contemplating maybe that watermelon deal ain't too bad. You know what I mean? It's pretty easy. So that went on for about an hour and a half, almost 2 hours, and I'm trying to look at the price, and my boss, apparently his favorite game as a child was the game Operation. Because what happens when the tweezers hit the side in Operation? Do y'all know what it sounds like? And so every time I made a mistake, he said, Whew. You know, by 11:50, I was really rethinking this situation, that maybe I hadn't made such a good decision about this part-time job at the chicken joint. And then I saw a big family start to walk toward Chick-fil-A. And big to me at that point was like 6 people. You know, there was like 4 kids, a mom and a dad. And I became a very religious person quickly, because I started to pray, Lord, please let somebody else get them. Lord, just let them go down there. And so I asked my boss, I said, I got to use the restroom. Do you think I can go to the restroom real quick? And he said, well, let's just get this family right here first, and then I'll let you go. And so the family walks up, and now I have a child. I don't know about you guys, but my child at that age never ordered for themselves. They got what I ordered them. I don't care that you want a sweet tea. What you're getting is water. It's free, and there's no caffeine and no sugar. You know, but these parents had a different perspective about their children ordering, because their children kept changing their minds. And my boss kept doing the And I said, oh, Lord. You know, again, I became very religious. By the time they had all got all this order in, and I had yelled back and told them what food I needed, I got my drinks made, I got them set up here, whew, I repeated the order, I went through all the steps that he had been teaching me all day long. And we got to the end of this thing, and these big cash registers, they are not like they are now. Like, if my kid hits $20 bill on the cash register, the drawer opens and it tells you how much change to give. You know, there's a little subtotal button. You can tell them how much they owe you before you hit anything else. Well, this one, you didn't know the total until you hit the button. So I hit the button to give them their total. And up here on this real high counter on this 50-pound register, the drawer pops open. And I had been very meticulous about placing all my 6 drinks up here, right in front of the drawer. So you know what happened next, right? All the drinks came tumbling down. And I was wearing those black shoes that my boss told me to wear, which were dress shoes, because that's all I had. And they were a little slippery on the wet floor. And so in the midst of all this, I tried to jump back to keep from getting splashed with these drinks. And so I began to start slipping and falling. So I grabbed hold of the register to keep from, you know, hurting myself. The 50-pound register that was plugged into the wall, that now it's me and the 50-pound register that's falling down on the floor in a mall in the 80s at noon on a Saturday. And so now the register is coming up, and I am falling, and it's falling with me, and the long cord yanks out of the wall, and it flings around, and bam, right in my boss's forehead. Oh, yes. Yep. And so there I was in the middle of the floor on a Saturday about 12:01 with the cash register on my chest and my boss with a welt on his forehead. And he just looked down at me. He said, "You know what? I think you can go on home for the day," as he's helping get that up. And that was my first official work day at Chick-fil-A.
Wow.
Yeah. And so anytime that I have a young person start working with me, I say, I can assure you that your first day is going to be so much better than mine. And I'm still here 26 years later. And so I try to make sure that their first day is nothing like mine. But that story, customer service guru, you think they really went together? Absolutely not. I hated the sight of a cash register. I became a skilled professional at everything else in that restaurant. I could squeeze lemons faster than anybody else. I could wash the dishes. Oh, we got a mess up in the bathroom. Oh, I'll go clean it. I mean, I was the one in the mall with the chicken on the stick. You know, I mean, I was good at everything. And I became good at the register as well. I became good at waiting on customers. I followed the script. I did what I was told to do. I made all the right suggestions. Did you want to get a large fry with that man? But I did not enjoy it. And I think that all of us have had someone to take care of them that did exactly what they were supposed to do. They followed the script. Good morning, Vincent Bynum School. But they didn't do it with joy. And there is a huge variance between the two. When you do something, you follow the instructions, and when you do it because you have a passion for it, because you love it, because you have a heart for it, because you want to, not because you got to. There's a huge difference. Well, I was 15 then. I worked at Chick-fil-A all through high school, worked at Chick-fil-A all through college, and I did exactly what I was supposed to do. Nothing less and nothing more. If I saw a lady that had her hands full and was trying to manage 2 kids, when the transaction was over, it was over. I said, I won't help her to her table. That's not part of my job description. That's not what I'm supposed to do. Nobody told me to do that. So I didn't. Well, my degree is in elementary education. So I went to East Carolina, and my senior year of college, I was like probably a lot of people that come from the background that I do. I was in debt. I had a lot of school loans, and fortunately, I'd made a lot of good contacts in working with Chick-fil-A. And my boss hooked me up with Chick-fil-A corporate and was able to give me an opportunity to go run a store for them. That was a very interesting store, by the way. The first day that I was there, I thought that they had kittens, that they were letting their team members bring kittens to work, because I saw one moving behind one of the refrigerators. That store's not open anymore, by the way, so don't be scared. But it wasn't a kitten. Yes. So it was the mall was a real crazy. That mall was, they had a lot of stuff going on. But I had an opportunity to go run a store, and that was great because they were going to pay my bills. They were going to give me a check, and I had a job lined up, and I was going to be back in North Carolina by August, or the end of August, so that I could start teaching school. And so while I was there, I wanted to do the best that I could possibly do. I got the store cleaned up, I served hot sandwiches, I did everything that I was supposed to do. I even loved on my people a little bit. Even then, even though I didn't like my customers very much, I loved my people. But we had a great time talking about some of our customers. You know, I mean, whew, I was the ringleader, boy. Now here she comes. She's going to come down here and order a sandwich with cheese and bacon and a large sweet tea. And then she's wanting to know how many calories are in a waffle fry. I mean, I had jokes for days. And so, fortunately, I was intelligent enough to know that I needed to work on that customer service skill. And so I attended a customer service seminar. And I would say that that was a pivotal point. You know, I think a hot word today is game changer. Well, that was a game changer. The first couple of people that got up and spoke, I really thought, what time is it? What time is this going to be over with? But the third lady that got up was a bank teller. Well, now, my immediate reaction when she told us what she did, where she worked, was, oh, whatever. I wear khakis to work every day. I smell like a nugget when I leave at night. You know, I'm nickel and diming, $5 here, $5 there. You're handling all this money every day. What do we really have in common? But then, as she's talking, she said, whew, I tell you, I was so glad when they built a drive-up window onto my bank, because we had a lady that we called the cat lady, and none of us could stand her. And I was so glad that I didn't have to deal with her anymore. And I said, oh, yeah, okay. And my little ears perked up because I had some of those cat ladies that ate chicken with me. And so I was very interested in hearing how she got past that and how you could fake it until you made it. You know, what I got to do? So she began to tell us about Mrs. Smith. And Mrs. Smith was an elderly lady that didn't have many family members nearby her, but she did have a house full of cats. And Miss Smith was having problems walking. So oftentimes when they saw Miss Smith get out of her car, they'd go run and open the door for her. And if you weren't careful, Miss Smith would sneak a hug real quick. And she smelled terrible. And they were all like, oh God, it's gonna get on my clothes. There's always cat hair on her. You go do it. No, it's your turn to do it. It's your turn to do it. Go ahead now. Go on. And so she said that month when Mrs. Smith came, she said, it was my turn. She said, but I didn't care because we were building a drive-up window. And I knew this was going to be the last month because Mrs. Smith is having problems getting around anyway. So all she's going to have to do now is just kind of stick her little check out the window and woo, she's gone, you know. And so that month when it happened, she said that she ran over and she opened the door for Miss Smith and invited her in. And she said Miss Smith went in for a hug and she didn't even mind. She gave her a big old hug. And she said, Miss Smith, I'm so glad to see you. And she said, well, I'm glad to see you too. She said, I have got some exciting news for you. I know you have trouble getting in and out of your car and getting in the bank. She said, next month when you come, you will not even have to get out of your car. We're building a drive-up window. You can drive through the drive-through, stick your little check out. We're going to put it in there, give you a receipt, and you're going to be down the road, Miss Smith. You're not even going to have to get out of the car anymore. And she said that Miss Smith teared up. And she said, I would never do that. I would never do that. She said, my kids live out of state. The only time I really see my kids and my grandkids is on the holidays. And she said, y'all are what I look forward to. She said, I love coming into the bank. She said, sometimes I just come up here to get change for stuff just so I can see you guys. And sometimes you give me a hug. And she said, and this year you even gave me a Christmas card with cats on it because you know that I love cats. And she said, I felt this big. I'd given her that Christmas card as a joke because she was the cat lady. And she said, and I really genuinely felt like I could not even swallow. And guys, I'm gonna tell you, for me, that was the game changer. That was a moment that I said, oh man, how many opportunities have I missed out on? How many experiences have I had with Miss Smith? Or the customer that was always such a jerk or grumpy that I treated them the same way they treated me. That I had just given them the basic requirements and not one thing extra. And it changed me. It changed who I was. It changed what I was doing. Because up until that day, I had been selling chicken. I'd been selling chicken for about 6 years. But I never sold chicken anymore after that. I knew that that was just the way that I was going to serve others. And it was so ironic to me that I had went to school for 4 years because I wanted to serve people. I wanted to help people. I wanted to be a positive influence on others. And there I was. At that time, I was having 400 people a day walk through that restaurant and interact with me or one of the people I was paying. And I totally missed out on the opportunity. And so when you think about what you do, I think I always focused on the what. Somebody walks in, I say, hello, what can I get for you? I get you your food, I say goodbye, my pleasure, come back and see us. I focused on the what. I didn't focus on the why. Now, some people will say, why I do what I do is because I need the money. I need to get paid. That's why I do what I do. But why? We spend about 70% of our waking hours at work. Gosh, I hope that you're there for more than a paycheck. I'd hate to know that 70% of the time that you're awake, that you're just there for the paycheck. Wouldn't you want to make it bigger than that? Wouldn't you want to go ahead and take opportunity to do something with that time, to serve others, to do it with heart, to go beyond the requirements, to really add value to yourself? I don't know about you guys, but when I do something nice for somebody, it makes me feel good. I think I'm almost selfish now. And it's a real challenge when somebody's rude to me. Because then I'm really going to be nice. I'm really going to kick it into third gear then. You know, I'm going to see how nice. I'm going to see if I can get a smile out of you. I'm going to do it. So in preparing for this, I visited 3 different schools over the last couple of months. I visited an elementary school, visited a middle school, visited a high school. Just because I wanted to see, what is the customer service like in our school system? I mean, it would have been naive of me to think that I could talk to you about customer service in the school system and it be anything like it is at the chicken joint, right? But I was wrong. It is kind of like it is at the chicken joint. So, I'll tell you about one experience that I had. I got to a school. I went up and, you know, you got all those monitor things. Has everybody got those now? You can't even open the door. And, you know, I'm not real techno savvy with stuff like that. But there's this box here and a speaker here, and I didn't know what to do with the box or the speaker. And I just kind of looked at it. I pulled on the door. I couldn't get in. There was nobody around. What is going on with this thing? And really, for me, and again, maybe it was just me, I didn't know where to push it. Like, I was pushing the little speaker box. And so a lady came on. She said, push the silver arrow. I said, oh, okay. I pushed a silver arrow. Hello?
Yes, what is your business here?
I said, oh, okay. I'm here. And I told her while I was here. And something happened with the door, and I was able to come in. Now, meanwhile, while I was standing there, and it was very cold, by the way, and I don't like cold, there was a gentleman that was probably from here to that screen that saw me. He was in the building. Now, he was looking at me. He didn't wave. He didn't offer to assist me. He just stood there.
And I said, okay, all right, this is not so good here. And then I went to the office, and the lady that was working in the office, I think, was having a bad day. She seemed a little frantic. She was on the phone, and she was trying to talk to somebody that was in the office next to her. And she said, yeah, can I help you? And I said, oh, yeah. I got some good stuff to talk about when I go now. Because it was fun, you know, it was fun. And I told her what I was there for, and she said, yeah, do the computer thing there. Get your thing, get your tag, and you can go on. And I said, oh, okay, what do I do? What is this? What do I do with this? What am I supposed to do? It's got a thing. It's going to take a photo of me. I see the, and so I fumbled through that, and I figured that out, and she was still busy doing other things. And then I said, hey, I don't know my way to the room I'm going to. Give me just a minute. And so she goes out into the hall, and she said, hey, and she gets the guy that's standing out, can you take her to? And he said, yeah, I reckon. And so he took me. And so that was my first experience. Fun, right? Fun. Okay. Second experience. Go to the school. The door is actually propped open. I don't know why, but it was. So I let myself right on in. I said, oh, this is much easier right here. This is great. No, but I knew what to do that time anyway. You know, like I would have known it's the silver button with the arrow on it because she had told me about that. And so I went on in So this time, the lady that assisted me said, you know what to do with that? And I said, yeah, I do, because I had already been. Had I not already been, I would have probably needed some assistance. But apparently, I still didn't do very well at it, because I messed something up, and the computer did something. And so she had to get up from where she was sitting and come help me. And I don't think that made her happy. She was not happy that she had to stop what she was doing and help me. It was not a good day. But we got through that, and I got it, and I went on about my business. And I had a student that actually had met me and taken me to the room. So that was nice. They were waiting for me. It was an anticipated arrival, and that was great. My other experience, which was my favorite experience, involved somebody that is actually here. I went. This time I was very skilled at how to get in the building. And promptly, I mean within 5 seconds, somebody said hello, greeted me, and I was able to go in. And I went on to the office, and this nice lady here greeted me with a smile and a hello. As soon as I came in the door, hey, Christy. Now, I don't know if that's because she knows me or if that's the way she is with everybody. But it was amazing. It was remarkable. It was something I told other people about because I was blown away because of the other two experiences I had had. Because I just assumed after two experiences like I had had that that's the way it was in all the schools. And so my third experience was the saving grace. I said, oh, we got hope. We got hope. This is good. And she said, what are you doing today? And I told her what I was doing. And it was just a kind of, I'm checking out the school. My son, we're thinking about sending him to the school next year. And she said, well, let me see if the guidance counselor is too busy. If she's not too busy, maybe she can come on up and talk to you. I said, wow, this is great. Would you like to meet the principal while you're here? Oh, man, this is really something. Guidance counselor wasn't available. Can I get your phone number, Christy? I'll get her to call you back. That afternoon by 4 o'clock, she had called me back. Man, that was different, huh? Such a different experience. So let's talk about the first experience. So this is the part where you guys get involved. Y'all remember the first experience? What went wrong first?
Agreed. You couldn't get in the door.
I didn't know how to work market. Has anybody got instructions on them things? Some of you do, some of you don't. Okay, well, not everybody does. Okay, so some of you've got instructions. I think that's number one. How is there an expectation of how long it should take you to respond to that? Because when it's cold, you want it quick. Is there an expectation?
From the person pushing the button, definitely.
Absolutely. But the people that are in the office, is there an expectation? Have there been expectations of how long it should take?
No. We don't know until they push.
I want y'all to do me a favor. Vicki, I'm going to pick on you. Count to 20 for me out loud.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20.
Okay, multiply that by 4. You know how long that felt? Multiply that by 4, and that's how long I waited for somebody to respond to me while I was standing out in the cold. 80 seconds. I timed it. Now, I know when we say, hey, it didn't take me number 20 seconds. Jesus, God, I don't know what she's so upset about. But did that 20 seconds feel like a long time to you guys? Imagine if somebody's called you and told you that your child has thrown up and they're running 101 degree temperature and you have flown all the way from work to get out to Stantonsburg Elementary to pick your child up. And then you're waiting out in the cold for 80 seconds to get your child. By the time you get in, you ain't nice. I'm going to tell you that. Because you're probably about halfway sick, too. But you had to go to work this morning. And right now, your boss has told you, you can go get him. But you need to be back here in an hour. That's your lunch break. So that's the mentality that I'm walking into your school. And I'm trying to get in. And I can't even get in. Okay, so that's number one. There should be a clear expectation about time when we're greeting anybody. Because it might not mean much to you, but it means a lot to them. So what's the next thing to happen when I got in the school?
There was somebody that was standing there.
I didn't think that happened in the South. We're Southern. You see somebody, you wave. You know, you smile. That's just what you do. I mean, that should be kind of a rule of thumb, right? You see somebody, you smile, you wave. But certainly, it's like if you came to my restaurant and there were a couple people standing back there and they weren't doing anything, but they wouldn't help you. They just looked at you. I wonder if she wants some chicken. Somebody will get her in a minute. So that's kind of my feeling about that guy. Was like, man, he's just standing there. I mean, he could at least say, they'll get you in 1 second. They're going to buzz you. You know, or he could have came up to the window and say, she going to get you in just a second. Or maybe he could even open the door for me. But do the people that you work with, does your school have a welcoming environment? Do the people that you work with that are the first point of contact, do they seem like they want people there? Do they smile? Do they act like they see you when you walk in? I said the word game changer earlier. Have you ever noticed how one negative person can influence everyone around them? Well, let me tell you, positive people do the exact same thing. Mm-hmm. Boy, you have to work with somebody happy every day. It's hard not to be happy. At first, you want to hit them or pinch them. But then after a while, it just starts to rub off on you. You can't help but to be happy around them. So when you guys go back and y'all start talking about these little things, these little nuances, be that person that everybody wants to pinch because you are so daggone happy. Why are you so happy? So, I'm inside the school now. The guy didn't want to take care of me, but, you know, I did get in. I got in after 80 seconds.
So now I'm in the office. What happens next?
The lady's too busy.
She's too busy. Mm-hmm. I bet that happens a lot. I mean, I bet you guys are busy a lot, right? Mm-hmm. So if you're busy, what can you do not to make the person that is walking in feel like an inconvenience?
Smile.
Yeah. You can be in the middle of a conversation on the phone and you can say, I'm going to be right with you. Good to see you. Come on, buddy. Yeah, gotcha. So you can do those things. It does not mean that you still can't greet them. You can still smile and you can be busy. You know what I tell my people being busy means? It means job security. Because when you ain't got nothing else to do, they don't need you. So that's the way I look at it. Busy. Woo! I've still got a job. That's what I tell my folks. So what happened after that? Y'all remember? The computer. Oh, Lord. I think about my mom. You know, my mom, she just turned 61. And she started very young. And still, if my mom went into a school system and tried to use that computer, she would not know where to begin. She wouldn't know what button to push. So I think that assumptions have no place in your office at all. Don't assume that somebody walking in knows what to do. How nice would it be if somebody said, can I help you with that? Have you used one of those before? Asking questions. Now, we're going to come full circle in a minute, and I'm going to tell you some things that will help you remember all this very easily. But it would have been nice if she had helped me. And I consider myself reasonably intelligent, but my photo, I didn't like my photo because it was just kind of the top of my head because I was still looking down. Well, then the next thing was getting to the classroom. Y'all remember how I got to the classroom? Smiley that greeted me when I came in took me to the classroom. And he was not happy about it. I think about when we talk about, what does the word guest mean to you guys? I'll pick on you now. Tell me, what is the word, if you've got a guest coming to your home, what do?
You greet them, smile.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What else do you do?
Serve them.
You serve them? Mm-hmm. Anything else? Great hospitality. Now, we did a spiritual gifts inventory thing at church a few years ago, and I was happy with mine because mine said that I had the gift of hospitality. And I said, yes, Lord, I'm doing the right job then. That's good. But when I think about having a guest over to my house, and I tell all my team members this too, I make sure the house looks right. Mm-hmm. You don't want nobody to come to your house and it not be right. I mean, I might light a candle. I want it to smell good. I want everything to be in place. When they get there, I'm opening the door for them. Me at my house, I'm hugging them. Hey, how you doing? It's good to see you. I'm so glad you're here. I'm offering. I don't say, how can I serve you? But I say, you want something to drink? You want something to eat? You comfortable? You good? Relate that back to your schools. How do you make your guests feel? How comfortable are they? What about when they leave? When my guests leave, I don't just stay in the recliner. Bye now. I'll see you later. I mean, I walk them to the door. I'm walking out to the car. They're probably like, Jesus Christ, let me get out of here. Are you going to let me leave? And so how are you treating your guest? I gave you three different scenarios about how I was treated as a guest in your school system. If this is where you spend 70% of your time, wouldn't you want it to be the best? Wouldn't you want everybody to say, I'm going to tell you, boy, whew, you go to Toys Not Middle School? They have got some sharp people working over there. They are nice to you.
Yeah, I went over there. I was supposed to speak to a class about business, and one of the teachers was in the office when I arrived, and she said, why don't you let me walk you to the room? I'm going that way anyway. Now, I know probably more than anyone else in the school systems, you guys sitting in this room right now have more interactions with parents and teachers than anyone else does. You see them more. When I was doing my student teaching, there was teachers I never saw unless we had a faculty meeting. But you guys see people on a regular basis, don't you? So what does that mean about the influence that you have? I'd say you're the most powerful person in the school. When they see the principal, they ain't like, oh, yes, there's the principal. He's visiting my room today. Great. No, but when they see you, when they come in to pick up their mail or run copies or whatever they're doing, you've got an opportunity to influence. And influence is the most powerful thing in the world. Influence. So you could be the game changer. You could be the one that's rubbing off the positive. So, I want to tell y'all just, I'm a storyteller, so you'll have to forgive me for that, but I'm going to tell you one story before I go. Chicken, I told you that we stopped selling chicken. We started serving people. And we literally think up, once a month we do brainstorming about kooky ways we can really amaze somebody. I encourage you to go back and do that. Do that with your buddies in the office. Do that with your principal. Do that with the staff. Think of kooky ways that y'all can impress people. What does that look like when somebody walks into your office? What does that look like when somebody presses the button? We're going to answer every button by the time fives are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We're going to get it before I can count to 5. We're going to answer the phone on the first ring every time. Maybe you do some kooky stuff that's unrealistic. But I'm going to tell you, when you make unrealistic goals, you'd be surprised. One of the goals that we've made at Chick-fil-A is that we're going to answer the drive-thru headset before we can count to 5, before 5 seconds. We've made a goal that we were going to take care of every guest within 2 minutes of them entering the room. We're doing something crazy right now, and it is a little crazy for fast food, I guess, that we want to go to every single guest's table and take their tray away before they have an opportunity to get up and take it. We don't want them to have to take it, and we don't want to put a sign that says, leave your tray here, we'll take care of it. No, we want to have that interaction with them. So think up stuff that you can do just to move the needle just a little bit. Okay, so back to story. We tell all our folks the why in the beginning. Now, we teach them the what, but they know the why. Why do we do this? Why? Because of the Miss Smiths. That's why. Because of the people that we are the only smile they see all day long. That's why. Not to sell more chicken, but to have more influence. Because if we're nice to that person, when they leave, maybe they'll be nice to somebody else. Y'all see all those commercials on TV about how, you know, the guy picks up the little girl and now she's going to do something. It's true. It really happens. That's what we try to do there. So, story. We teach them the why. We had a situation where a guest came in. It was pretty late in the evening, 9:30. We close at 10, so 9:30 is late to us. And they ordered 2 of our meals with regular Chick-fil-A sandwiches with no pickles. So 15 minutes later, the gentleman comes back. The young lady that took care of him now literally gets hit with one of the chicken sandwiches. He threw it at her and said, my sandwich had pickles on it. And he had a lot of other stuff that I'm not going to say on camera. Y'all can talk to me later. I'll tell you what he said. But he said a lot of ugly stuff after he hit her with the sandwich. And so this young lady had been trained and talked to about this whole influence thing, being nice to people. And we specifically talk about it is pretty easy to be nice to people that are nice, right? It's pretty nice. It's pretty easy to be nice to one another. We treat each other with honor, dignity, and respect. But man, when it gets difficult, when you can really see somebody's true colors, is when somebody is mean to you. How do you react then? And so this young lady showed her true colors. She immediately said, "I am so sorry. We have obviously upset you. What can I do to make this right?" And he told her, but the summary of what he told her was, "You can get me another sandwich with no pickles on it." And she did, and she gave him his money back. Gave him a coupon for the next time he came. And he left. He didn't say thank you. He was still mad. She did all that, and he left. He was still mad. So, about a week and a half later, I checked the mailbox at Chick-fil-A, and I got a letter in the mail. And I began to read it. And it's from this guy that had acted so crazy and threw the sandwich at my sister, by the way. So then it really was personable. It was very personal to me at that point. And as I began to read the letter, I started crying. Because it was a Miss Smith situation. The gentleman had gotten ready for work late that morning, went back out of the driveway. His three-year-old didn't get a hug before he left, and so he was running out to give his daddy a hug. Daddy literally backed over his three-year-old. Him and his wife had been at the hospital all day long in intensive care, and they hadn't ate. It got later. The cafeteria had closed, and they knew that Chick-fil-A was great and that they always got what they wanted there, and the service was nice, and there wasn't going to be any reason to get mad. And so he skipped the other restaurants and went to Chick-fil-A, and then went to Chick-fil-A and had a terrible experience. He didn't get what he wanted, and that was kind of the breaking point for him. Now think about how different that scenario could have been. Because he goes on to say, "Thank you so much for teaching your people how to treat others, even when they don't treat them very well." And I think about, I don't know what I would have done. I don't know what I would have done if I'd gotten hit with a Chick-fil-A sandwich. But I sure am glad that the person that took care of him did, that they believed in the why, that they knew even when somebody called him on the phone and was fussing them out about whatever it was at Vince and Bynum, that they knew how to handle that person with honor, dignity, and respect. So that's kind of my final story for you guys. I do want y'all all to stand up real quick, though, because this is the summation of what we've been talking about. It's going to help you remember what we've talked about. So what you're going to take back from today, even if you don't take back anything else, is these little hand gestures to help you remember some of the key things that you got to do to be remarkable. Points. What do you think this is?
Eye contact.
Make eye contact. What do you think this is?
Smile.
What do you think this is?
Breathe.
Speak enthusiastically. Because you don't always get to see them or smile at them, but they always hear your voice, don't they? Do you think when you drive up to a drive-thru, you can tell whether somebody's happy to be there or not? Even so much now that a lot of fast food restaurants have a pre-recorded voice that comes on because they know their people don't sound happy. We got a new speaker system installed last year, and it has that feature on it. And my managers was like, "Miss Christie, we're going to turn that on." I was like, "No, we're not going to turn that on. That's ridiculous. You know we can sound happier than that speaker can. So how do you sound when they can't see how you feel? Can they hear how you feel? Can they hear it? Can they hear that you're happy to serve?" Last. Do this. You can do it on either side. I don't know which side it is. I think it's somewhere in the middle. But stay connected. That's that last one. It's the heart thing. Remember the why. Staying connected 70% of your time. 70% of your waking hours. Wouldn't you want to give your best? Gosh, it'd be crazy not to. It's just a waste of your time. So, what's this? What's this?
Smile.
What's this?
Speak enthusiastically.
Yes, speak enthusiastically, yes. And what's this? Call it whatever you want to. But we want to stay connected with their heart. Because it doesn't matter what kind of day they're having, they remember that.
Uh-huh.
Thanks, guys, for having
me. After today's presentation, what steps are you going to walk away from this meeting and implement in your school? Okay? And so we're going to have you talk with your table mates and then, you know, jot down a few things that you're going to walk away with. And then we'll just, you know, at toward the end, we're going to have you share some of those things that you came up with at the table and we'll chart. Okay? All right. So we'll take about 20 minutes. Now, just because I was at this table here, okay, and I heard some great ideas, I'm going to put Tanya on the spot. Hey, I'm sorry. I just happened to be at the table. And again, you know, this is about spreading the wealth here, all right? I mean, and, you know, a lot of great ideas that you all shared at this table, and I'm sure we're going to go around and hear some more, but it's about people hearing that and going back and impacting their staffs at their schools. Please share what you just shared about what you all are doing to just really lift the spirits up of your folks.
Well, what we've been doing actually is working. We have what we call Secret Buddies, and I know all of you probably familiar with Secret Buddies. Some of them only use them at Christmas time, but we came up with the idea that we have Secret Buddies throughout the entire year, and at Christmas you use that same Secret Buddy. Well, just to encourage one another, we ask for their, maybe they have some of their favorite things. So we drew names, we got the secret buddy. So we say twice a month, but if you want to do it every day, it's up to you. It's just a word, just kind of encourage one another. We'll buy gifts, stick it in the box, or even just a little sticky note to help that suppose, you know, your teacher, and I said, you know what, all right, that you're doing such a great job, or thank you for your smile. Something encouraging to uplift the staff members. And they love it, so we get so excited because we're looking at it in the box for something. My secret buddy knows that I like tea. I like to drink a lot of herbal tea, and I like coffee. So she said, have a drink of tea on me today. You know, I have a tea. She bought me tea, different varieties of tea, plus a cup of mugs. And she laid it on my desk. I don't know what she is, but I think I knew. But they said, no, you don't know. But it's just something, it's just to help one another, because you never know. And she was saying what people are going through each day. Also getting to know a person. When I was in banking, it was this young lady that was there. She wasn't a morning person, but I had to find that out because she was kind of hateful coming in and not speaking. But when I got to know her, she realized, she said, Miss Hannah, she said, Tanya, we were personal events. And she was like, Tanya, you know, I'm just not a morning person. Well, hey, I found out that she wasn't one person. So every time I made coffee, I would bring her a cup of coffee to her desk and find out how she liked it. So that kind of helped everybody, because we all go through a stressful day. We're human. We're not going to agree on everything. But that helped so much. I'm going to tell you all, that environment, the kind of there, has been so much better. So much better. So I think that's a good idea. We'll reveal our secret buddies at the end of the school year.
Fabulous. Great process. Just, and see, it doesn't take much. Just a few key things. And I mean, and you hit on a great point, and I think, you know, when Christy was speaking and really talking about that last story about that gentleman who had come in and had, you know, that morning backed over his 3-year-old. I mean, that's powerful. And see, you don't know. You have no idea what people are going through. All right? And so, you know, sometimes it's about encouragement.
Yeah, that's right.
Because you don't know, you know, what somebody has in their heart or carrying on their heart when they walk in that building every day. And, you know, we go out, we do a lot of climate work, and we work with a lot of schools. And we always, when we set the tone with schools, we always ask the question, how many of you guys, when you get to work in the morning, just wait in your car about 5 minutes and take a couple deep breaths because your chest hurts before you can walk in because of the climate? Hands just... All right. And if that's the case, then why don't we do something about it? Okay? So encouragement. Thank you. Other thoughts? Ms. Tate?
I was in the newspaper.
Yes, you were. Yes, you were.
So if someone rings my buzzer, first of all, when we got it, we recognized right away that there was no instructions.
Right.
You had not put the signs up yet. And so we were busy running to the door, telling people how to use it. So I said, there's a better way. So we made a little sticker. It said, press here.
Mm-hmm.
And so it made a little sign with instructions that they had been installed, and we were excited and how to use it. And we didn't have any problems after that. But our greeting is, welcome to Forest Hills. May I have your name and the reason for your visit? And they tell their name and the reason they're there, and we ask them to come in the middle door, and then we give them another good greeting when they come inside.
Awesome. Awesome. Now, do you all have a time limit, like what Tristy mentioned, as far as a set time limit that you say, okay, I'm going to respond to this person this amount of time?
Well, as soon as it buzzes, I answer.
Okay, so
now,
that's
unless
it.
Unless I'm on the phone, and then sometimes I have to put someone on hold on the phone so that I can answer the buzzer, because there's no way to tell them to hold on if you're talking at the same time. So I ask the person on the phone, could you hold, please? And they'll hold, and then I answer the door. Then I get back to the phone call.
Wow. Wow. So again, I mean, we put those systems in place to keep our kids safe, and parents love that. But at the same time, you know, it's about customer service, and it's about creating that welcoming environment. And so coming up with processes like you guys did at Forest Hills, and I'm sure at other schools, where parents can come, you know, they push the button, they know their kids are safe, but then they get this warm welcome, and they come in, and it's all good. So thank you.
A lot of it's personal, because you become to know a lot of the parents.
There you go.
But then you recognize when there's somebody different at the door, and I think that's great, because you need to know that there's somebody different, mm-hmm. and with a different need, and then you want to be able to expect trouble too if there's trouble at the door. That's why they were installed.
Sure. Okay. No, thank you. Great ideas. Any others? Different tables. Heard a lot of great things happening. Yes, here. Oh, here.
Do the smile thing. This
was
actually one thing I had mentioned in my interview.
You sure did.
Talking with Mr. Davis, and I don't know if time goes by so fast, and I guess it was a lot longer than I thought. I don't know if any of you had attended our rock and roll customer service training session. Okay, because it's been a long time. Anyways, one important thing I took from it, our presenter at the time said, picture on your phone, or literally put a happy smile, sticky face on your phone handset. And that's to remind me, before you pick up a phone, smile and be smiling as you answer the phone. And it sounds so corny, but I do that every time I answer the phone, and I literally have people saying, oh my gosh, I can see you smiling
that's
through
right.
the phone. I can hear you smiling through the phone. And it really, really works. And so that's already putting you in a mindset to have a much more pleasant voice when you're answering a phone. And it's really simple and easy.
That's
so
right.
I feel like all of our secretaries, bookkeepers, clerical, should have that little smiley on their phone.
That's right.
Maybe that will be my first gift to you.
That is awesome. Thank you for sharing that, Maureen. Other thoughts? I know that we were going to share something. Yeah.
We discussed, you know, about the computer sign in and sign out.
So you've made it in the building now, and so now there's the okay, yes.
And so, you know, if they need assistance, if they're not familiar how to do it, we would, you know, go around and help them and assist them. So maybe, you know, wouldn't feel uncomfortable if they wouldn't have to.
To just walk them through that process and so forth. Because again, I mean, going back to the presentation, you know, how treating the folks who come in your building like you would if someone came to your home, really, you know, and rolling out that red carpet, right? I mean, it made you really think about it, like, okay, well, how she mentioned how, you know, you put on the candles and just making sure that you, you know, are very welcoming in your home, but then when we get to work, it's like, you know, hey, how you doing? All right, just get there the best way you can. I mean, again, you know, it's just thinking about it in a different way. So thank you. And again, I mean, I'll just, you know, call you out because, I mean, you know, she had a very welcoming experience at your school. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you for what you do. Other thoughts? Yes?
The volume of the phone calls that we get throughout the day, parents ask about what time is practice, what time my child went through this, what time ASD is over. I share with this group at Babyfield, we have a daily bulletin that I send out with a lot of information on that bulletin each day. So that when the phone call come in, the bulletin is there for you to give that answer. You don't have to put the person on hold. I go to the AD, ask about a sport event. It's right there for you.
Having it all right there. That's awesome. Awesome. Now, what about some other things like with our website or your websites? You know, I mean, are you all thinking about doing some things to make your websites more welcoming? Okay, and again, I mean, that's just one of those things that I think, you know, I mean, really, when parents go to your website or they go to any part of your building, that sends a powerful message, because if they see that the website's updated and they see that there's current and accurate information there, I mean, they shouldn't see, you know, last year's, you know, information there or last year's roster and teachers who have, you know, left the building and, you know, 2 or 3 years ago, or, you know, it's like the close of the year and then you've got the principal message saying, you know, welcome back to another great school year. You know, I mean, no, none of that. That's outdated. And so it's really looking at all of that information and doing an audit, if you will, on websites, newsletters, anything like that. Other thoughts? Yes. Yeah. Okay.
It's not by knowledge of people when they walk into, once they get in, the office staff not acknowledging the person as they stand in there. Mm. You have to stand and wait. That is one of my worst pet peeves. I hate it. I experience it all the time. And me, myself, I'm the first person that they see when they walk in, so I acknowledge them. If it's nothing but good morning or good afternoon, can I help you? But to have to stand there more than 2 seconds to be acknowledged, I don't think any parent, any whoever come into the building should have to stand that long. Mm-hmm. I think they need to be acknowledged right then.
Right
then. The conversation you have, I think it needs to stop at that moment and wait on the customer, then go back. Unless it's something, you know, working with a sick child, naturally you're going to work with that child first.
Yeah.
And all. But you can at least look up and say, I'll be right with you. Give me a minute.
Mm-hmm. That's right. See, now, and I'll go back, thank you for that, because, you know, again, I mean, she's talking about what happens at Chick-fil-A. I mean, you could talk about what happens at Food Line or anywhere like that, or any retail store, department store, I mean, where they have quality customer service. And here we are, we're dealing with a parent's most prized possession, their child, and sometimes they don't get the best experience like they would in a Food Line or Chick-fil-A or whatever. And so it's our job, right? Our jobs to change that paradigm, okay? And she said it. You are the most important person at building, okay? Yes, and it's not the principal. As a former principal of 3 different schools, I'll tell you, I depended heavily on my secretary because she was the front line, okay? Teachers came to her like they come to you, okay? And I can tell you right now, the tone of the building was set by the secretary or bookkeeper, okay? The tone of the building was set. Yes.
Talking about secretaries, I'm so good welcoming our guests and so forth. I thought some of yourself did the same thing. I've seen Mr. Battle, as well as Ms. Lucas. Can I help you?
That's right.
They step right on in.
That's right.
Can I help you? How are you doing today?
Yeah.
Mr. Battle knows the full stream. That goes from not only the principals, all the way down to the custodians.
And again, thank you for sharing, because you know, just like negativity breeds negativity, positivity breeds positivity. And if you've got someone who's positive and modeling that enough, that stuff starts to rub off. It does. And so again, in filling out these strategy sheets and these personal action plans that you'll go back and implement in your schools, think about it. I mean, because yeah, you're going to have those ups and down moments all the time. All right. But if you can really commit to yourself, and just like I said before, when you get up in the morning, you look in the mirror and you say, you know what? I'm going to have a good day today. Okay. Regardless, I'm going to have a good day today because a lot of people are dependent on me. A lot of people, because I go back to what you shared earlier. You never know how someone else is feeling, and you don't know what they're going through. Just like that guy at Chick-fil-A, okay? He came in and he wanted to go to Chick-fil-A because he wanted a good experience. You know, I'll share a story with you about my own life and how encouragement really impacted me. I can remember when I was in Lynchburg, Virginia. That's where I started my career as an elementary principal. Small system, 11 elementary, 3 middle, 2 high schools. And then when I moved to Montgomery County, Maryland, it's a big school system with over 200 schools. Okay? 200. So I was a principal there. And I can remember it was about April of that school year. And I can remember being in the school on a Saturday preparing for the 5th grade promotion ceremony. Okay, and I was making a PowerPoint, you know, because I was going to put all my kids' faces up there and really we were going to celebrate. Okay, and I remember just like it was yesterday, I got a knock at the door on a Saturday. It was the PTA president. And she came in crying, tears in her eyes. And she said, you know, one of our 5th grade students, somebody I'm running her picture off and scanning the pictures, had just been in a car accident up the road, okay, and killed. I mean, we cried, man, we cried. We cried for like 10 minutes. And after we cried and kind of got ourselves together, we said, all right, you know what, we gotta be strong. We gotta be strong for kids. We gotta be strong for the parents and our community. So, you know, got ourselves together and we, you know, put a plan together. So Monday went by, Tuesday went by, Wednesday went by, and then Thursday hit. Thursday's the day changed my life, okay? Thursday. Now, I'm dealing with all this stuff. I mean, you know, now, and I've never dealt with that as a principal. The loss of a child. I mean, there's nothing more devastating, okay? 5th grader, running her pictures off for the 5th grade promotion ceremony. Then I get a call from my little sister in Lynchburg. All right, I'm in Maryland, but my little sister in Lynchburg. I could hardly hear because she was crying. Okay? She called me at work telling me that her 5-month-old baby was at the babysitter's and the babysitter wasn't watching him, so he suffocated. Now, let me tell you something. That was a bomb that dropped on me. I had just lost a student, and then this thing personally in my life. Now, what did I do? I went to Lynchburg to be with my family. And I'll tell you, I mean, I was contemplating not coming back because that was just too much pain at one moment. And I go back to, you never know what somebody else is going through, right? And I can remember being at home and really thinking, all right, you know, I got to get back and I got to do this and I got to do that. And I thought, all right, well, you know, and I, you know how you just prepare your mind for like, all right, you know what? I've had enough pain. I don't need this anymore, okay? I'm just going to just, you know, I don't need to come back to work, okay? I can do something else. Then I got a phone call from my community superintendent, okay? And I thought to myself, you know what? This is going to seal the deal for me because if he tells me I need you back here right away, guess what? I ain't coming. You know what he told me? And it's the reason I'm here today. He said, Eric, he said, we love you, man. And he said, if you need us to come down there with you, we will. And you take as long as you need. That's what he told me. This is my direct supervisor. Guess what I did? I got my act together, got myself prepared to come back and be strong for my students and my community. And I tell that story because, again, words matter and encouragement is everything. And so when we go on this journey together, and we start talking about customer service, it's about how we interact with people. And you are in a very powerful position to touch lives. And every person who comes in and snaps at you, or they're mad, and or some parent that comes in and just angry, remember, you're dealing with that parent's most prized possession. If you fool with anybody's baby, they see red, okay? And so if we could just get to the crux and the root of why it is that they're angry, maybe we can understand how to work with that parent more efficiently and more effectively. And I say all that because when you leave here, okay, so that this just won't be another one of those presentations and workshops where you just feel like, okay, well, we heard a lot of good information, then things got busy again, and then we're back to doing the same old things that we did. Commit to making and taking some action. Commit to taking some action. And you're going to have a professional network opportunity here, because I'm going to tell you, this lady over here, Maureen Hooper, as you all know, is fantastic. You know it, okay? And she's committed to facilitating these meetings and incorporating elements of this stuff in them. And so the next part of what we're going to do, as I mentioned to you at the beginning, is I want you to fill out that needs assessment. I want you to fill out that needs assessment for her. Let her know what you want to see in these meetings, how frequent you want to meet, and how you really want to make the focus go into next year. This is not this year. This is going into next year. Because again, thinking about your role, thinking about the powerful, positive influences that you have, we're stronger together, aren't we? All right? So again, let's take about 3 or 4 minutes to fill out that sheet. And then we'll have a few closing comments, and then we are done.